Red Robin, yum. Now that is catchy. All I have to do is drive past one and that thing is in my head for the rest of the day, and you're welcome for putting it in your head today. Do you know these restaurants? It's their 50th anniversary this year. They're not as big as, say, Applebee's or Chili's, but still pretty big. 573 locations in 46 states and 2 Canadian provinces. They make over $1 billion a year. Maybe you know their mascot. His name is Red. I mean, come on, he's adorable. They sell these gourmet burgers, and they really emphasize the gourmet parts and all the signs. Their stock symbol is RRGB because their official name is Red Robin Gourmet Burgers. That word helps separate them from McDonald's and Wendy's and the million other places selling the fast food version of the same thing. And personally, I don't even care about the burgers. What I like is their bottomless steak fries. Oh, they have this big container of seasoning at the table. Just put some of that on there and there's no such thing as running out. There's only more on the way. But enough of the fries. I'm getting sidetracked. Let me give you some facts about Red Robin. The average check per guest is $12.92, including beverages, and that's actually down a little. The burgers range in price from $6.99 to $15.49, and I'll talk about this a little later, but people tend to gravitate toward that lower end. They have 27,283 employees, most of which are part-time, and the average restaurant employs about 58 team members. In all honesty, I think it's a cool place, but they've been having some troubles. Here, this stood out to me. I pulled it from their 2018 annual report. Look at the top line. It shows that if you invested $100 in Red Robin Gourmet Burgers Incorporated at the end of 2013, you would have made a little money in 2014 and then lost tremendously ever since. Today you'd have about $35 remaining. The two lines below it each compare an index that reflects the performance of the rest of the market, both of which have done much better. I do want to talk a little bit about this, but I'd prefer to focus on how Red Robin got so big, because there's some interesting stuff here. I want to tell you about how they got started, but first, can I tell you about one of my new favorite songs? It's an oldie. It was originally recorded by Al Jolson in 1926. The song is called When the Red, Red Robin Comes Bob, Bob, Bobbin' Along. There's been a bunch of versions over the years, but the one I've been listening to the most is Bing Crosby's from 1956. I recommend you listen to this, and if you like it, I have a second recommendation. Set this as your alarm. In my opinion, you cannot do any better. It's a nice, relaxing song that literally tells you to wake up and get out of bed. Look, I know it sounds lame, but give it a try. I guarantee you'll be humming it for the rest of the day. Maybe it'll get that other jingle out of your head. And one more cool fact about this song, the restaurants were named after it. This dates back to the 1940s. The restaurant we've been talking about started as a tavern in Seattle, Washington, near the University of Washington, owned by this guy named Sam. So logically, the name of Sam's Tavern was, well, Sam's Tavern. Now, Sam was a singer in a barbershop quartet, and he loved this song even more than I do. And I'm confident in saying that because his love for this song motivated him to change the name of Sam's Tavern to Sam's Red Robin. Then in 1969, this guy named Gerald Kingan bought the tavern and transformed it into a full-on restaurant, much like the one we know today, and changed the name simply to Red Robin. Yum. As I said, it's their 50th anniversary, so that all happened exactly 50 years ago and is considered to be the start of the business. For the next decade, Red Robin existed as that single location. During that decade, they had this other guy named Mike Snyder as a regular customer, and he must have been a big fan of the food because in 1979, he opened the second Red Robin as a franchise location. Believe it or not, Mike Snyder is easily most responsible for this company's success. Early on and throughout the years. He continued opening these franchise locations, while Kingan started opening more company-owned locations. Within the next 5 years, there were 20 new Red Robin restaurants. From here, Kingan decided to sell the majority of Red Robin to a larger Japanese company called Skylark. Now, Skylark was only involved for about a decade because they didn't seem to be too successful in running these restaurants. They did do some good things. Red Robin became much bigger Jaeger under their control, and they're even the ones responsible for introducing the genius idea of the bottomless steak fries, but for whatever reason, they had trouble running these restaurants. The least profitable locations were the company-owned ones operated by Skylark, and the most profitable locations were the franchises operated by Mike Snyder, which prompted a few changes. In 1996, Mike Snyder became their new president. Soon after, Red Robin cut their ties with Skylark and named Mike Snyder their new CEO and chairman of the board. And initially anyway, what a terrific choice this turned out to be. Think about it, the whole reason he got involved in the first place was because he was a loyal customer. So he's obviously passionate about the company. He's been operating locations for 16 years now that are generally more successful than the others. I'd say you couldn't have a better leader at this point. Right away, he started making some big changes. First and foremost, slow down with the expansion. He went through on a restaurant-by-restaurant basis and figured out where they could cut costs and improve efficiency. In 10 of these cases, the restaurants were performing so poorly, he decided it wasn't worth it to save them, so they were closed. He also put together a new upper management team and expanded the menu. Maybe his most important change was treating the employees in a way that would improve the customer's experience. To motivate them, he implemented this performance-based reward system, basically aligning everyone's goals. If the restaurant did better, the employees would see benefits from it. He was known for promoting this customer is always right type attitude. It was done by giving the employees special authority to make decisions. Like, if it's been 30 minutes and you're still waiting for your burger, the waiter has the power to say, this one's on the house and we'll give you an extra order of onion rings to bring home with you. Under Mike Snyder's first 5 years in charge, he successfully turned all of it around. The company-owned stores that were struggling under the control of Skylark were now generating significantly more sales and were significantly more profitable. This is their revenue graph over that 5 year span, and keep in mind, they weren't really opening new stores at this time. The increase is mostly due to better performance at existing locations. The sales jumped from an average of $2.1 million per location to $3 million per location, and the profit margins went from 13% to over 19%. So, once they had everything under control, the next logical step was to get back to expansion. They now had a solid business that was bringing in money, so I'd say the smart idea would be to open more locations and bring in more money. To fund this expansion, they became a public company for the first time ever. The initial public offering sold 4 million shares at $12 per share, bringing in around $48 million. Also, they set up a credit agreement that gave them access to an additional $40 million. They now had nearly $90 million and were ready to put it toward opening new restaurants. The year this all happened, in 2002, they had 198 locations, and their plan was to soon get that up to 850, which, well, 16 years later and it's yet to happen, but they did grow. Within 6 years, by 2008, they had more than doubled in size, around twice as many locations with well over twice as much revenue, while keeping comparable restaurant sales well into the positive each year up until 2008. From there, they slowed their growth because they hit a bit of a rough patch. The economy was having some issues at that time, which isn't good for a gourmet burger place, especially since they tend to target the middle class. 2008 through 2010 were pretty tough. Things did improve from there, in some aspects, up until the last few years. Comparable restaurant sales have not been good. In 2018, their overall revenue decreased for the first time since that economic downturn a decade ago. And of course, the stock price. I talked about that earlier. Here's some popular theories for their recent decline. The industry, in general, is becoming more competitive. You have IHOP pushing their burgers, and other restaurants getting more aggressive in their prices and menu offerings. But since Red Robin isn't nearly as big as IHOP, or their more direct competitors like Applebee's or Chili's, they don't have the same resources to compete. They may not be able to afford to lower their prices as much or to pay as much in advertising. Another reason, in an effort to save money a couple years ago, they cut out a few job positions, which forced those duties onto other people who weren't trained too well, and it just slowed down service while making everyone busier. It resulted in higher customer wait times during busier periods, leading to unhappy customers who are hesitant hesitant to return or potential customers leaving when it's too crowded, you get the picture. And in their defense, they've since recognized the issue and are now putting a huge emphasis on cutting down those wait times. Another possible reason, as I hinted at earlier, more and more people are gravitating toward their lower priced menu items, passing up the higher priced hamburgers in favor of the cheaper ones, and they have combated that by strategically raising a few prices. That's what they're dealing with today, but I want to go back to Mike Snyder, the owner of their second ever location in 1979, the hero, I guess you would call him, behind their turnaround, and the mastermind CEO behind their public offering and followed expansion, because things took quite a negative turn from there. It was found by the SEC that from 2002 through 2004, Mike Snyder falsely reported $1.2 million of personal travel expenses as business expenses, which I fear doesn't sound as bad as it actually is, because it's terribly illegal. It causes their reports to be misrepresented, which are used by the public when making investment decisions. It's essentially stealing and then lying about it. When the news broke, it prompted a class action lawsuit from the shareholders who felt the company had been misrepresented. He paid back the money really quick, but the SEC announced that they would be investigating it. It all led to Mike Snyder stepping down as CEO and a panic to replace him quickly. A couple years later, it ultimately led to a $250,000 civil penalty paid by Mike Snyder. It was all a huge disaster for the company, and I'm sorry to say that there's even more sad news to report concerning Mike Snyder. In December of 2018, at age 68, he died. TMZ reports it was a self-inflicted gunshot wound to the head. There was no suicide note or anything, so the circumstances surrounding this are unclear. I have very mixed feelings about this guy. He's responsible for the success of one of America's most well-known restaurants, but he took advantage of it in a negative way. Either way, this is sad to talk about. Boy, you know, I wish there were a happier ending to this. Let me know in the comments, what do you think of Mike Snyder? It's not black and white with this guy, but also, what do you think of Red Robin? Are they strong enough and unique enough to recover from these recent troubles? Personally, I feel like a lot of their issues are things that are easily fixable, and they do have a strong brand. But on the other hand, you have to be really good to survive in this industry. And have you ever eaten there? And what's your opinion of them as a customer? I'd like to hear what you have to say. Thank you for watching.